This is the Kratom Science Podcast. I'm your host, Brian Gallagher, blog and social media writer for KratomScience.com, your source for all things Kratom. Michael Napolitano kicked a decades-long opiate addiction with the help of Kratom. Mike is 57, from New York City, and served in the Army. His opiate addiction spiraled out of control and contributed to a life of violent crime and prison. This is his Kratom story.
Were you like a combat veteran? Is that where you got your gunshot wounds?
No, I wasn't a combat veteran. More like a, you know, combat street guy.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
You got your, like, PTSD and anxiety from prison.
Yeah, because basically, yeah. The Army was just like a, you know, it was like a phase to me. I enjoyed it. I went through everything. And, you know, I mean, I missed Vietnam. I was in right after Vietnam was over. I got in. So
yeah.
I didn't see any war, but I see my own war when I got to, you know, to the streets. And, like, you know, the situation was, what happened was, is I was in the wrong place, the wrong time. Guy pulled out a gun and he shot me in the face, in the cheek.
Oh,
and
man.
I put two in his head, and I put two in his nephew's chest, and that was it. That's what I wind up.
So that's why what you went to prison for.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. Do I regret it? No, he tried to take my life.
Yeah.
Why would I regret it?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? If you're gonna take, it's either me or you. It definitely ain't gonna be me.
Yeah,
I'm not gonna
say,
okay, kill me, and go about your business. You know, I mean, really. So I just did what I had to do, and that was it. You know.
Yeah. So when? Why do you think you started getting into heroin and stuff like that?
That actually, you know what? That started out. I started, it's a long, I mean, I have a long history. I started using when I was 15. I started out with the weed. I started smoking a weed age 15. And that was, you know, no big deal. I started, drinking some beer. And then what happened was, I was at my grandmother's house and I was going through a medicine cabinets and I found some Valiums and stuff like that. So I ate a couple of those. I felt nice. And then, next thing I know, it was just like, you know, just to get away from stuff. You know, I would take it to like just to, you know, to get away. You know what I mean? To get out of my own head, like, you know.
Yeah,
to get
shit.
And then it just became like a, more like a, you know, I can't say like a peer thing. Like with people just hanging out with everybody, you know, and just everybody's getting high and you just, you know.
I
want to get high because I want to feel in place. And then after a while, it was a party. It was a party until I was maybe 19. And then after that, it just became a habit. You know, it just became a habit. One day I'd be like, oh, I'm going to just do it on Friday and Saturday. Then it became Saturday, Sunday, and Monday. Then it became Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. And then the next thing I know, I was using just about every day.
Yeah.
You know?
So did that continue all through, like, the military and prison?
Actually, no. Actually, it stopped when I went into the military.
It stopped,
and I didn't do it. And then after the military, I got out. And I stayed clean for a little bit, and then it started again. And what was it? It started again, and then when the incident happened, it started, and I wind up with a hap. Well, this is when I came out of, I didn't do the heroin until I was about maybe, I think I was about like 22. Whatever.
Okay.
I started, I tried it in prison was the first place I tried.
Yeah.
And and what happened was is when I got out of prison, I caught a habit. I had a habit. And next thing I know, I started doing armed robberies, robbing banks and, you know, whatever. I was robbing, you know, I was robbing everything. I was sticking up everybody, you know, I was robbing everything not nailed down, you know. And then, you know, I wind up, you know, in the incident that happened, and that was it. And I kept doing the heroin, just like, you know, it made me out of it. I hear people say that they love heroin. I hated heroin because of what it did to me, you know, because what happened was once I got on it, it's like you're not doing it for the high anymore. You're doing it because you need it. You know, you need it because, you know, you got
to
do it
normal,
because
yeah.
to feel normal.
Yeah.
That's where I got to that point. And I don't think I've ever felt high again since, I mean, like I was 22. I never felt like that again. Every time I just used it was just to stay normal. And then after what happened was, is I was using a little bit in prison. I mean, people say, you know, I had a good, you know, but I hate to say it, I had a decent prison life. You know, because I had people coming to see me. I had people bringing me drugs and, you know, and life was good in prison. I mean, even though I was where I was, the only thing I didn't have was, and I had that. I had a girl coming to see me every couple of months. So we got laid. You know, I had a trailer visit. So, So everything. So what else did I need? I didn't need nothing. You know, I had everything. Actually, when I left, I felt bad. I was leaving guys. They were like, "Well, Mike, take it easy out there." I was like, yeah, you know. And, you know, so what happened was is when I got out, I stayed clean for maybe about a month, and I started getting high again. And my parole officer, I was on parole. So my parole officer said, "Mike, you can't do that. He said, I'm going to have to violate you." And I was like, "Oh," he goes, "but listen, here, I got something really good for you. Here, get into this program, and we can't say you got a Derry Young." So they sent me to the methadone program, you know. And at that, when I was that age, I really didn't, research nothing or whatever. So I said, fine, I'll go in the methadone program. So I went in the methadone program, supposedly for 6 months to a year. Before I knew it, 13 years passed, and I was like walking death. My life was like, you know, and that was like, I had actually, I had heard a little bit about Kratom, but I was like, yeah, it ain't gonna, you know, it ain't for me, whatever, at that time. But they tried to actually put me on Suboxone to get off the methadone. But here's another situation. What happened was, is I get in a badass brawl with the cops. They beat me within inches of my life, and I get locked up. They lock me up for assaulting them. Okay, so this is after that happened, the jail time. So I'm on Rikers Island, and I have no methadone. I'm kicking. I kick cold turkey. I kick methadone. I was on 80 milligrams a day, cold turkey. I kicked that. I don't know if you ever know, if you know anybody that kicked methadone cold turkey. That is a really hard thing to do.
Yeah.
And I did it though. I kicked it in prison. I kicked it, you know, and when I got out, I wasn't on anything. And there I stayed. Yeah, I stayed. Oh, found out I had hep C when I got out of jail for that. Yeah. I found out I had hep C, but I had it. I got it when I was in the Army. I went into the Army, the inoculations. That's how I got the hep C. And what happened was is I had to take the treatment, you know, the treatment. And I got it knocked out of me. Thank God I got it out of me. But I stayed clean 6 years after that happened. I stayed sick clean. After I took the hep C medicine, it did something to my brain where I was like, in my mind, I said, well, you know what? Cocaine is not my drug of choice, so I could do a little coke every now and then. Yeah, okay. Sure. You know how that works. You know what I mean? Yeah, I could do a little. Next thing I know, I'm doing cocaine and heroin. I'm speedballing. I'm doing it. You know, I'm really getting seriously, you know.
Yeah.
And, you know, and that's what happened. I was after 6 years of being clean. And I was like off the races after that. I was like, I just picked up where I left off. And even more so. And now I was like, you know. So basically, I've been using since the age of 15, you know? I've been using since the age of 15. So often, like, well, I had, you know, minutes of, like, maybe a couple of weeks and maybe a few months, but I was, the most I was ever clean was 6 years that when that incident happened.
Yeah.
And, and so bringing it all the way up to now, you know, it's like I said, since the Kratom, I don't even have the slightest thought. You know, I can say, and believe me, I know people that have and this and that. And I've had like people text me, Mike, yo, I got something. I'm like, yeah, I'm good. Don't worry about it. You know, I lose my number. I'll block them. I get really like, you know, when somebody tries to push that shit towards me, I'm like, it ain't happening. You know what I mean? I'm just not.
Were you completely clean when you started using Kratom or?
I was actually I got everything out of my system for about maybe 5 to 7 days, and after that I just the Kratom, boom, and after that it was like boom, life was like everything was, you know, I was like, I couldn't believe it. I was like, I said, I cannot believe I'm actually functioning, you know what I mean?
I think like a lot of people say they have to detox first and then they start the Kratom for like the withdrawals.
You know what it is though, you know, I'll tell you the truth, what it is people have to try it before they believe it. You know what I mean? You're not going to, I mean, yeah, because I just did it on, like I said, I got it from my friend John, and it was like, I said, all right, let me try it, you know, and, you know, it worked for me. I was like, wow, I can't believe it's actually working, you know? I wasn't looking for the high, I was just looking not to be sick, you know? Mm-hmm. And then, you know, I mean, there was some Kratoms that I did. I didn't feel high, but I got that, you know, that warm, fuzzy feeling like you get from the heroin.
Yeah.
You know, I got that feeling. I was like, wow, that's like, but it was like a feeling, like it was a body feeling, not a, like a nodding out, scratching up.
Yeah.
It's like
a
feeling like of well-being. It was like, it's amazing. Like really it is.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, honestly, like anybody ever asked me about that, I said, this is like the best thing that's happened since like, you know, since sliced bread.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Cause it's really, it really is. It's like amazing. I mean, the I mean, I've gotten a lot of people, you know, turned on to it that were having a hard time and everything. And they were like, Mike, they couldn't thank me enough. They were like, Mike, I can't believe that.
Yeah.
At first, they were like, and as soon as they took it, they would call me up, yo, where can I get something? I was like, I said, yeah, I'll give you the vendor. I'll give you the link to my vendor and, you know, you get it. And, yeah, but you know what it is? It makes me feel good to know I can help somebody out. You know what
yeah.
I mean? That I can give somebody the same push that I, you know, I mean, it's helped me. It's like a miracle plant for me. So I tell everybody, anybody that asks, I give them, you know, the whole miracle spiel.
So when did you first start using Kratom?
August 2018. I had an incident with the car. I was using pain, you know, prescription pain med, and then I couldn't get my prescription pain med, so I was using street drugs. So I was using heroin, snorting heroin, and what happened, you know. Sometimes, like, I guess bad things happen for a reason. What happened was is I hit a pothole, my tire rod snapped, and I hit two parked cars. So I pulled up like maybe half a block away, and I pulled up. And when I pulled up, I got out of the car, sat down. Next thing I know, I'm being locked up. Because I wanted to be honest, because I really wasn't, you know, I was just calm. I was just relaxed because I wasn't high. What happened was is the malfunction in the car. But me, I figured maybe I can, you know, I could tell them that, you know, I took my medicine that morning and whatever. So me, like a jerk, I tell them, you know, oh, well, yeah, I took my medicine early that morning. Next thing I know, I'm in handcuffs and I'm in jail. I'm in central booking. And they arrested me for driving under the influence, leaving the scene of an accident. And, and hit and run. Check that out. They made me sound like I was like, doing a mass car chase or something,
yeah.
You know? And here's the kicker. What happened was is I figured, yeah, even the cop, he goes, he said, you'll be out. Don't worry about it. You'll be out tomorrow. So when I go, not tomorrow, 2 days later, I go in front of the judge, and the district attorney blows me in the asshole. He says, oh, this man, because I did 18 years. I was locked up for 18 years. Yeah, but I've been home since 96. He's putting it out there like it just happened, everything, you know. He goes, this man is a menace to society. He's a judge. No, but listen to this, though, because the judge was, I'm not giving the judge props, but I had to give him props for that, because the judge looked at him and go, are you done? He goes, yes, Your Honor. And I'm asking for a $10,000 bail. I was like, what? A $10,000 bail? I seen a guy that just molested a little kid go out on ROR and everything, and they're going to give me they want me for $10,000 bail. So anyway, the judge goes like this. Nah, I don't think so. He goes, first of all, sir, you're going to give me your license. I says, you got it, Your Honor. Boom, I threw that license at him. I was like, here you go. I was like, he goes, okay. He goes, now I'm going to ROI you and you got to come back. I was like, thank God. And he didn't listen to one word the DA said, which was good. You know, the DA, like, you know, it was like a flashback, because I haven't been in that situation. And that I came home in 1996. So that's how long it's been since I've been in any, you know, anything, you know, with the law.
Yeah.
So that was like, to me, that was like, I was like, wow. Oh, it was like flashbacks. I was getting like, you know, my head was like going all kinds of crazy, you know? And
yeah.
right there and then I was sick and tired of being, using, you know, the opiates and street drug. I heard a lot about Kratom before that. You know, people were like, yeah. And my friend, I had a good friend of mine that was telling me, Mike, yo, he said, check it out. So I started Googling, and I said to myself, it couldn't be any worse than the shit that I, you know, they gave me, Mr. Paul, where right before that, somebody tried to hook me up with a bad bag to kill me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they gave me a bag and it had fentanyl in it.
Oh,
and
okay.
I went out. I was like, I almost went like kind of a seizure, and they took me to the hospital and everything. This was like right before that happened. So that's why I was going, you know, right before that thing with the car happened. So everything was like led up to that. And what happened was, is like I said, I was looking, doing some research online about the Kratom. And a friend of mine, see, like I have a lot of friends from drugs in the street. You know, a lot of friends that are, you know, using Kratom to stay off of it, you know, stay mm-hmm. off the opiates and stuff. He's
okay.
Red Devil Kratom. He's had some, actually his stuff was, his Kratom was like, it was like top of the line, fresh, everything. And he was a friend of mine. So he gave me like about $200 worth of Kratom for like $50, you know, because he was a friend. He was a good friend. And
yeah.
I know him for a while. He goes, Mike, here, if I can help you out, if it's going to help you stay clean, he goes, here, how much? I had the money. He goes, no, just give me 50, actually 60. He hooked me up with some CBD lollipops and all of that. And that's right there. Right there and then is when I started my Kratom, like, journey, I call it, because ever since after that, it just made me out. To this day, I was just telling my daughter, I said, you know what? I said, since I'm taking Kratom, I don't even have a thought of, like, a street drug or anything else.
Yeah.
Kratom is all I need. It takes care of my anxiety. It takes care of, like, the pain that I got. I got bullet wounds in my face and my back. I got arthritis throughout my back. What else? I got some, I got a pin in my finger. You know, I got all kinds of, like, you know, different pains and stuff like that. And being locked up all those years, I have, you know, serious PTSD.
Oh, yeah.
You know, from being locked in a cage for all those years. And I was in, like, the worst prisons in New York. So,
yeah,
you know, which was no joke. I seen guys get stabbed in the eyeballs and, like,
man,
their head just, like, you know, like spikes going through. Like, only stuff that you would see in a movie.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I seen it all. And I tell you, I sleep like a baby at night, you know, since taking the Kratom, I sleep like, and I don't abuse it. I take between my tolerance went up a little bit. I take between 6 and 7 grams 3 to 4 times a day, which that ain't, I thought it was a lot, but a lot of people say that's about right. You know,
oh,
and it's
yeah,
been like, I've been taking
yeah.
that. Yeah, that's for 14 months. And I think maybe I got like the wobbles like 2 or 3 times,
uh-huh.
You know, and that's what really burns me up is when I see articles where they do it, where they're portraying like somebody overdosed on. There's no way I could eat a whole pound of it and would know, you know what I mean? That's what gets me sick. That's like saying, if I drink too much coffee, I'm going to die.
Yeah,
you know, that's what they're saying. Like, you know what I mean?
I think it's a lot of people, like, lying. They're still on heroin, and they're telling their spouse,
yep.
It's just kratom.
You know what it is too? For a person like me, that I'm a street guy, and I've been doing drugs since I'm 15. I've been doing like street drugs and whatnot. So I know the lie. The lie is, yeah, oh no, I'm not. I'm just taking the kratom. And meanwhile, they just did 3 or 4 bags of dope, and you know, they're not saying nothing. You know, and once you do, and if you add the kratom doesn't do nothing. The kratom, honestly, when I took, here's another thing. When I, after that happened, I had like three or four pain pills left. And one day, like, I was like, I didn't feel like mixing, you know, because I take the kratom and I put in the grapefruit juice and, you know, the little ritual. One morning I woke up, I was like, let me take one of these pain pills. No, actually, I took the kratom first, and then I took one of the pain pills. I was like, wow, what the hell? Did these things go stale? I don't feel them. They actually blocked it. Like, I mean, because I was on the methadone program years ago for years, and I know that methadone is a blocker. It blocks any opiates.
Yeah.
You know? And that's exactly what the kratom did. I was like, wow, it's amazing. I was like, wow, good. I just took that one pill and that was it. I said,
wow, so it completely, like, knocked out the effects of the pain pill.
Exactly. I didn't even feel the pain. So I was like, wow. That's like, you know what I mean? I was like, wow, this is like, I mean, honestly, the stuff that I hear about Kratom is like amazing. And like what I've experienced myself is like, is far from, I have like a, you know, what happens is when you, you know, I can't explain the feeling to people. You have to know, you have to take Kratom to know the actual feeling, because it's like a body, it's not a high, it's like a body feeling. Like,
yeah.
I can't compare. I could compare it maybe to like some of the drugs, the good feeling that I'd like, the euphoria, the really good, like, well-being, you know, like you get like a certain, like, you know, sense of well-being. Like, it's like, you know, I can't even explain it, but, and,
definitely.
And you know what the thing is? Yeah. The thing is this too. I've taken it actually in 14 months. I've taken it every day for the last 14 months. I think maybe I went 1 or 2 days without it. But here's the thing. I see people talking about withdrawals. I don't see any withdrawals. I don't have one. I just felt like a little, like, tired, like as if I missed a cup of coffee. That's
yeah,
all.
Yeah.
I guess to each his own. Certain people, they put it in their mind that they're going to get something, and it happens. But no, I was like, I stopped for like a day, and I was like, why do I have to? There's no reason for me to stop. It's not hurting me.
Yeah.
You know, or if anything, it's just helping me, you know?
Yeah.
And like, you know, everybody sees it. My wife sees it. My daughter sees it. My son sees it. Everybody sees it. You know, that I'm totally like, you know, I'm normal again. Put it that way.
Yeah.
That's what it does. It makes me normal. I'm not scratching. I'm not robbing anybody's, money or sticking nobody, putting a gun in nobody's face and all like that. I'm
yeah.
not it's just not me anymore. It's just me and my dog. Like, we're just, you know, I've a couple of times, actually I gave him a little, cause he has like the hip. He takes pet CBD, but I gave him a little bit of Red Valley one time, not even maybe like a dab. And I said, God, I'll never do it again. Cause I thought I killed him. I gave it to him and he was knocked out. He was fine though. He was fine. But yeah. What happened was I gave him like a little bit. He was tall. He was ass out. He was on his bed. He was like snoring away. I'm like, Spanky. I put my hand by his nose to see if he was still breathing. I said, oh my God, my heart was beating. I was like, and my wife was like, what'd you do? I said, no, he's just tired. I didn't want to tell her. I gave him, but you know why? Because you know what it is? Because people, I always check it out first. I'll always do like, you know, I'll research it first if it's possible. But they say that the dogs can ingest kratom, you know?
Yeah.
That's what I've read, but I don't want, my dog doesn't, he doesn't, my boy doesn't, he's, I got a boxer, he's a boxer, so he's a full breed, he's 4 years old, and he's like, you know, he's like really, like, I keep him, you know, I got him in, like, training, I got him right now, he's right next to me. Actually, my psychiatrist is going to make him my service dog, so, emotional support dog, I'm sorry.
Oh, that's cool.
Well, he's actually a boxer, he's a bulldoxer. They call him a bulldoxer, he's bulldog boxer,
he's cool.
A bulldog boxer. Oh, he's mad cool. He's like, he's a fanatic. He's like sitting here now. He gets a little irritated when I'm on the phone, but yeah. He's got to handle it. He does. Yeah. They're like humans. Like sometimes, I mean, cause sometimes he'll get insulted cause I'm not playing with him. Cause I usually throw his ball around, but he gets a little insulted, but he's my buddy. He's like, honestly, the unconditional love you get from that's like, all I need. I told my wife, all I need is my dog and my kratom and I'm good. Like I said, my experience with the kratom is like, you know, I can't, it's like phenomenal. There's nothing, I mean, there's no, I can't explain it, but I wish, like, I was telling my daughter before, I wish people were like, you know, that they take this and they take that. I mean, I took a course in college, body health and disease. So I basically know, you know, I always had that in my head, knowing what to eat, know what to take. And, you know, your body, you know, you feel yourself, you know, if your body's feeling something wrong or whatever, you feel that, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's common sense. So when I take some, like every time, like, and knock wood, I didn't even say, but the last 14 months, I haven't gotten a cold once. I haven't got a cold. I haven't got sick or anything.
Yeah, it seems, you know, like it helps with colds.
And I attribute that. Yeah, I attribute that all to the kratom because the kratom does, like, I mean, it may sound funny, but it's a cure all. Like, there's not much that it doesn't cure. I mean, if people talk about they get constipated and everything, I'm just the opposite. In the morning, I get up and boom, I'm like clockwork. Every morning I get up, boom. I filled the bowl. I'm good for the day. It's like, that's how I start my day. Every day, boom, you know, bathroom, bang. And here's the thing, too. I'm not working. I'm on disability. Like I said, the kratom, it's just like, you know, I can't say enough good things about it. There's nothing. And then I always look, like I go online. I belong to a few groups, too. You know, some other groups, like support groups, kratom support groups and whatnot.
Yeah.
And everybody, I have yet to see anybody that's in those groups give kratom a bad rap. Nobody gives it a bad rap. Unless, like you were saying, like, unless they added something with it, unless they did something and got sick or whatever.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
That's how, and here's how I look. I'm not a drinker, but we went out to dinner one night and everybody was having a drink. So, and I had like half a glass of wine. I don't really drink, but I had a half a glass of wine. I didn't even finish it. I took a couple of sips and I was like, oh my God, I was like twisted. I like, oh, I don't like feeling like this. I'm not, like I said, I'm not a drinker.
Yeah.
And it was because, you know, I took my kratom earlier.
Yeah.
And I was like, that's just something.
I've heard that. I mean, I talked to a guy that said he was like a heavy drinker for like 25 years. He started taking kratom. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, one day, he just stopped getting beers out of the fridge and he just doesn't drink anymore.
Mm-hmm. The only reason I did it was because everybody was drinking. It was, you know, they were in the restaurant, everybody was having wine. I said, I'll take a half a glass, you know what I mean? And I took a couple of sips. Next thing I know, I was like spinning. I was like, it was like I drank a whole bottle of wine. That's how I felt. I was like, what the hell? And that was after that. I said, nope, won't even touch liquor no more either. I was never, my mother worked in a bar for 30 years. I used to go in the bar all the time, stoned on pills, and be like, everybody like, yeah, well, I want when he's drinking. I'm like, you don't want when I'm drinking.
Yeah.
You know, I'd be at the end of the bar, whacked out of my face on pills, like, you know.
Yeah.
But since the kratom came into my life, like, all those, you know, everything, like, the way I used to be and everything, as far as, like, you know, oh, it used to be, I used to be, like, I guess I could say I used to live to, you know, they say you live to use and use to live.
Yeah.
That's how I used to be. I used to be exactly like that. You know, I had my life. Now I don't forget it. Like, I mean, I spend maybe, I think maybe $100 if I spend, if that much on Kratom, and it lasts me 3 months.
Yeah.
A good 3 months, you know, easily. And
yeah.
That's, and I get the good, I get some good, really very good, you know, very good quality stuff. Yeah, I tell you, it has so many benefits. It's even like in the sexual department. Oh my God, forget about it. I always was, you know, I never had a problem, but now forget about it. It's like, I'm like Joe Stud. I'm like, forget it. It's like amazing. Like my wife is like, again, are you serious? Again? What's wrong? I'm like, yeah, all right, again. Honestly, I'm 57. I feel like I'm 25 when it comes to, you know,
yeah,
not
because
I mean
benefit.
It's amazing. I mean, I see people say, oh, did anybody lose their libido? This and that? I'm like, wow, no way. Just the opposite.
Yeah.
I think, you know what? I think you can lose your libido if you abuse it. If you take too much, if you start, that'll do it. Because I noticed, like, if I took like maybe an extra, like a little extra teaspoon or something like that, it did make me a little like queasy, and it made me a little like, you know, less feeling like. But if you take it right, if you take it correctly, you know, stuff, anything in moderation is.
Do you just toss and wash it, or do you make it into a tea?
I make it. I take some pink grapefruit juice.
Yeah.
I warm it. I take like a quarter of a cup. I warm it up, and I mix it in there. I mix it with that, and I put it in the refrigerator. I try to keep it in there for, you know how people try to get the red bubble, you know?
Yeah.
They try to do the red bubble. I try to do that all the time, but it doesn't work all the time. But I get it, like, you know, I put it in there. I think it potentiates it when you leave it in the freezer, you know? That's what, yeah. I leave it in the freezer for maybe a half hour, 45 minutes, and then I drink it. I drink it up.
That's cool.
Yeah. I mean, it's funny. I look on all the, you know, on all sites and everything. I try to get a, you know, the concept of all. I mean, I honestly know a lot about it. You know what I mean? I know a lot.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I'm not an expert, but I know, I put it this way, I know enough to know what I got to do. You know what I mean? Without,
yeah. Definitely. And of course, because it works, they're trying to outlaw it in some places.
I think, you know what it is? I think the reason they're trying to outlaw it is because it's better than anything that Big Pharma has in store.
Yeah.
Let me tell you. As far as I can see, it's better. It's like health-wise, it helps a lot. Like blood pressure. My blood pressure was through the roof. Since I'm taking Kratom, it's normal. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I wouldn't take the blood pressure medication because I don't like to feel lethargic and shitty and whatnot. And since the Kratom, my blood pressure is normal as can be.
Yeah.
You know? So, I mean, you know, it's, believe me, it's got a whole lot of medical benefits besides curing anxiety, pain, giving you a little energy.
That's what I think. It should be out in the open so they can study all the stuff that it does. And it should be available and cheap.
Right. Right, exactly. I mean, they have the, like, I see it's got a lot of, they don't look at, you know what I noticed? They don't look at the science behind it. They don't check the science, you know, if you notice that. Like, everything, they're always trying to bash it, like, real quick. Oh, yeah, so-and-so overdosed from a large amount of, now, here, hey, check this, how's this one out here? They're shooting Kratom. They're shooting it and snorting it. I'm like, oh, okay, sure. I do that all the time. That's impossible. If you did that, your nose would be, you wouldn't be able to breathe out of your nose and your veins would collapse.
Yeah.
I mean, they actually have people believing that, though. You know, they put it out there in a news article. People go, oh, yeah, these junkies are going to shoot the Kratom. That's fucking crazy, you know?
Yeah.
I'm like, yeah, we're going to smoke it like we're going to put it in a crack pipe.
Oh, my God, that'd be awful.
That's like, oh, my God. They put that out there. Like, you know what it is? They poison people's minds about it, too.
Yeah.
You know, and then people are like, oh, no, I would never let anybody take that. Let me tell you, I would take it over anything that Big Pharma has to offer. I don't care what it is, Oxys or whatever they got. I'm not buying it. I'm not taking it.
Yeah.
You know, I'm in that you know, category where, you know, like Kratom is it. That's it. I'm not going anywhere. If I need medicine, that's my medicine. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's,
yeah.
You know, bottom line. I don't, you know.
Definitely. We're just trying to get people's stories out because the you know, half of the media you see, it's just, you know, this horrible, deadly drug. And
exactly.
Just overwhelmingly, like, the comments we get are just comments like yours, like, it's helped me. I don't have any side effects.
Exactly.
You know, I don't have any desire to go back to, you know, heroin
right.
or whatever it was.
Mm-hmm.
So we're just trying to get it out there as much as we can on our little blog here. Yeah.
I mean, anything, honestly, anything that's natural. Me personally, I'm a vegetarian also. pescatarian because I eat fish once in a while, and I've been like that for 30 years,
yeah.
even through using. So I eat, you know, they say you are what you eat. I try to eat as good as possible. You know what I mean? And vegetables and, you know, balanced diet. Because I had to, I took the course of nutrition when I was, you know, away in college. you know what I mean? I got all my benefits from there. I mean, I never applied them because I was too busy, you know, applying drugs to my, you know, my habits. So, but, you know, now I do better things. I cook and stuff like that. And it's, you know, I mean, yeah, life is good on with the Kratom. I can't say nothing more. I can't say anything better about it. You know?
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, like, if you would have asked my opinion of the Kratom, I think it's, like I said, the best thing since sliced bread, you know?
Yeah.
So, I don't eat bread, so I don't know. But I mean, you know what helped me stay clean the 6 years? I went to NA. You know, I went to NA, and I did a lot of service in NA. You know, I took care of, you know, whatever, you know. I don't know if you know, are you familiar with NA?
Narcotics Anonymous.
Yeah. Are you familiar? Have you went? You ever went or anything?
No, huh? No.
Well, I was into that for a while, for a good, but see, the thing is this, I won't go back, even though I consider myself clean, you know, the Kratom, I don't consider the Kratom a drug, you know what I mean, that's the way everybody, it's an herb, it's like, I have medical marijuana, I have a medical marijuana card,
I smoke
it, believe it or not, it's not that I smoke it as prescribed, because it's not prescribed, it's just the card, but I only smoke at night, I'll smoke a joint, maybe half a joint at night, and it helps, along with the Kratom, it really helps, put it that way.
Yeah.
I mean, my pain, all that I told you, all the pain that I was going through, a half a joint and my Kratom, I'm like, life is good.
Hell,
I don't feel nothing.
That sounds perfect.
You know what I mean? I mean, yeah. And I just, you know, I rock like that. That's all.
Yeah.
Enough is enough. Like, I can't do the other shit no more. So I said, something's got to help me. You know, and this thing is like, the Kratom is a miracle in my life, put it that way.
Yeah, it's definitely great stuff. And
that's
definitely has to stay legal. Mm-hmm. And,
exactly. That's
rehab centers would kind of consider it as as part of a cure instead of kicking people out
taking
it.
You know what? I was reading somewhere where they have a Kratom rehab. Did you know that? Did you know they have a Kratom rehab?
Oh, really?
Where they only use, I think it's in Florida. I was reading about it. I couldn't find it again. I've seen it where they bring people in and they treat them with natural herbs like the Kratom and whatnot. And wow. I mean, honestly, they'd have a lot of people coming out like fine after that, you know?
Yeah.
So, I mean, you know, I mean, these other, I did the whole rehab detox thing. And if it's not in you to stop, you're not going to stop. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's just the deal. You know what I mean? When enough is enough, when you say enough is enough, I mean, I'm 57 now. I wish I would have did it. Like, I wish I would have had this opportunity maybe 20 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
But you know what? I'll take it, you know, how it is. And I just live my life how it is. I'm 57. Hopefully I have another 57 years to go.
Yeah.
You know? That sounds a little far-fetched. It's 114, but, you know, I'm not, you know. I mean, at least if I could get another 20, 30 good years, I'll be happy. Believe it or not, I have a grandfather, a great-great-grandfather, that lived to be 105.
Wow.
He's 105 years old. So, I mean, honestly, yeah. So my mother always tells me, she goes, your great-grandfather, he has lived to 105 years old, and he was in perfect health. I was like, wow.
That's probably how you survived all the drugs.
Exactly,
good constitution.
Believe me, I overdosed like a number of times. I was in death's door plenty of times, and just, you know, God didn't want me. God said, no, man, I want you right now. Mm-hmm. Go back out there and do a little more research, you know?
Yeah.
That's it. And that's what happened. So.
This has been the Kratom Science Podcast. Thanks to our guest, Michael Napolitano, for his wonderful story of survival and redemption. For more information on all things Kratom, check out KratomScience.com. The music is by Rizzy. The song is called Memories of Thailand. Please like and subscribe on YouTube, Stitcher, Google Play, iTunes, Spotify. It's written and produced by Brian Gallagher.